what we're about to do yield favorable results. May it give us the capacity to benefit others. May it help us overcome ignorance and limitation. May it clear away all obstacles on the path. May it lead us to the union of wisdom and compassion. Om Ahum Soha.
Today we are in sort of like the grayish space. It gives you where we are in the text. Remember, we have in our version of the text, there's 63 instructions divided among seven particular points or keys. We're in the point of commitments. And these are the 22nd through the 28th instructions. The instructions are: always abide by three basic principles. Change your attitude, but remain natural. Don't contemplate others' defects. Don't contemplate others' weaknesses. Work with your greatest defilements first. Abandon any hope of fruition. And abandon poisonous food. Interesting commitments. This section of commitments is perhaps the most specific one in terms of the instructions for mind training. Not that all others are unimportant, but these are extremely specific instructions. So as usual, we will begin by reciting together the prayer and then going through each stanza and sharing what the lineage has instructed us about its meaning. I bow to the Lord of compassion. If I fail to observe my commitments, I betray my own purpose. If I make a show of my high view, I cultivate conceit. If I become one-sided, I fall into extremes. Bless me to remain scrupulous, discreet, and impartial. Like wholesome fruit, my practice ripens gradually and quietly. Like a lone mendicant, progress arrives without trumpet and drum. Bless me to remain natural. Yaks do not fly, and ravens do not till the soil. It is pointless and callous to comment on the obvious. Bless me to understand the common and uncommon appropriations. The impurities of others become mine when I see them. Revealing them to others puts mine on public view. Bless me to wash my face before mocking the mirror. If I free myself of the grosser defilements, the lesser will spontaneously subside. Bless me to meet fascination with mindfulness, hatred with patience, dullness with study, malice with gladness, and arrogance with modesty. Attracting followers, subduing enemies, fame and reward, respect and comfort are vain and selfish aims. Hope of success is fear of failure. Bless me to give up hope. All I think, speak, and do is tainted with self-grasping and self-cherishing. If I do not give up these two, even my cultivation will be a cause of suffering. Bless me to give up me and mine. It's getting pertinent. So, at the risk of boring you to tears, I will repeat. All these prayers start with reverence to the Lord of compassion, right? And by now, you should all be able to recite by memory, who is the Lord of Compassion? Is he an external being? No, he is an aspect of our own Buddha nature that manifests skillful means, right, in this particular case, to help us train the mind. And because we need compassion, not only for others, but for ourselves. If we treat ourselves harshly, necessarily, we will be harsh with others. Think about it. The vast majority of people who become abusers were abused. And that not only happens from the outside, it can also happen from the inside. So we need to practice compassion. That's why we invoke the Lord of Compassion, because we're dealing here with our main problem, which is the mind. And we could get very judgmental with our minds. Actually, when I was in India, there's a very famous, I will not mention him by name, because he's very nice and very holy. But his recommendation, his practice for his disciples, and he had thousands of them, was to beat their minds with a shoe. 100 times in the morning, 100 times at noon, 100 times at night, and if they woke up during the night, beat their head with a shoe at least another 100 times. And I see his point. He was saying, you know, of course this is for people who thought that the brain was the mind, but he was saying, this is the source of your problem, so if you want to blame somebody, blame the mind. The problem is, and I observed this because I was in close association with them for many, many years, they tended to become very judgmental of others as well. They were very judgmental of themselves, and they were very judgmental of others. They were always speaking of, he's a demon, she's a demon, he's a... not really what we want to cultivate, right? We want to cultivate compassion for others, so we have to start cultivating compassion for ourselves. So we invoke the Lord of Compassion to prevent our getting very judgmental with our own minds, because it's very easy to start saying, like, you know, you're the cause of all my problems, and I'm going to beat you up with a shoe. So the first stanza tells us, if I fail to observe my commitments, I betray my own purpose. If I make a show of my high view, I cultivate conceit. If I become one-sided, I fall into extremes. Bless me to remain scrupulous, discreet, and impartial. These are the three basic principles that we need to observe throughout our spiritual cultivation, and particularly through mind training. So what are they? They are being scrupulous with our commitments. Once we make a commitment, so these three principles that we need to observe throughout our spiritual cultivation, and particularly through mind training, are to, first of all, observe our commitments, right? Whatever there may be. The beauty of Buddhism is it doesn't tell you what you have to commit to, but it tells you when you commit to something, live up to it. Not because somebody is up there judging you, right? There are no cosmic being counters watching your behavior. It's because you defeat your own purpose. Why do you defeat your own purpose? Because the mind can be the greatest friend if it's trained, but it's also the greatest enemy. And it's the mind that tells you, you can't keep a promise. You can't keep that up. No, you can't do that. See, you failed. Here you go again. Right? How many times have you tried that? Right? And the mind starts defeating us to the point where we won't even try. It's useless. I can't do it. So keeping our commitments is the way to make sure, right, that we can tame the mind. The mind will give you all sorts of excuses. it's too hot, it's too cold, I'm too hungry, I'm too full, I'm too awake, I'm too sleepy, right? There's always a reason not to do the things that we supposedly want to do, right? Not now, later. So keeping your commitments is a way to strengthen not only your resolve, but to strengthen your capacity to control the mind. The real problem that we have is instead of controlling the mind is controlling us. The mind tells you where to go, what to think, what to do, how to feel, right? All the time. It's dictating, it's nonstop, it makes constant demands on you. And if you are trained by the mind instead of training the mind, then you'll be all over the place, all the time. Yes?
Tashi, when we're working with this, remember you talked about, I forgot what we call now, fat seeds, impressions?
Yes, impressions, fat seeds, yes.
As we do this, as we keep more and more of our commitments, are we making...
Fattening the seeds, yes. And eventually they will become formations. And when they're formations, then it's spontaneous. So it works both ways. The beauty of understanding the mind is that once you understand it, you can use its own structures for your purposes. Now, this brings up another point that is equally important. If you make a commitment, keep it. But what is the flip side of that? Don't make commitments that are beyond your capacity, which we do all the time. I will lose 55 pounds in the next 3 days. You know, that's an exaggeration, but we do that. By the way, I have a British friend who's just brilliant. He says, you know, lose 10 pounds in 1 day. And he promises that you will. He says, yeah, give 10 pounds to me. You know, that's the monetary unit. You can lose them in a second. Just hand them over. Right? You can lose all the pounds you want. We make commitments beyond our capacity. Actually, I was having this conversation. You know, when we approach practice, our teachers very kindly tell us, do not be too ambitious with your practice. Do something that is manageable and do it frequently until it becomes second nature. When you feel comfortable with the practice and the practice is integrated into your life, then add. Because if you take on a huge practice, you will develop aversion for practice. You will. It's going to be a struggle. There are people who get very, very ambitious, spiritually ambitious. And I saw these many, many times. In fact, when I was abbot of a monastery, one of my main jobs was keeping young monks from extreme practices. And, you know, the older monks we used, I know it sounds horrible, but this is true. We would look at them and the more, you know, ambitious and extreme they were in their practice, we would say like 3 months, 4 months. No, this one, 2 weeks. They would leave. They would leave. You cannot keep that type of intensity up unless it's slowly established over time. So we have to have a very nice balance between the urgency of practice. Right? It's urgent. You know, the house is burning. We have to get out. Right? But we have to get out in an orderly way. Like when we're doing like a fire evacuation, if everybody rushes for the door at the same time, we all die. Right? We have to, you know, make a little line, and, you know, if we're small, we have to hold hands and get out in an orderly way. So the same thing is with commitments. Make doable commitments, right? Realistic commitments. It is much more important to be consistent than to be, well, ambitious and falsely so. It's like if you promise someone, you know, people do this all the time in love, like, I will be with you forever. I am with you now. It's actually much more honest, sincere, and doable. Right? At least you're not dying. Like, first of all, no one can be with anyone forever. At least they got it right, you know, like, well, partially right, at least in the, you know, marriage ceremonies, they at least they do till death do us part, which is a little bit less than forever. But nobody can make those exaggerated promises and keep them. So be realistic, gentle, and consistent. Okay, so what is it? The second is, if I make a show of my high view, I cultivate conceit. Very often, and this is sad, but you know, very often when we start cultivating our spirituality, we get on this very, very high horse. And we basically make a show of our, you know, newfound spirituality. Well, I don't do that, I do this, and, you know, like, or in the middle of, you know, something, it says, well, you know, could you keep quiet, I'm going to meditate now, I'm going to go deep inside. Thank you. Or, I lived in New Mexico, in Santa Fe, at the height of the Santa Fe New Age trip, which was in the late 70s, early 80s, and even like, you know, waiters in restaurants, and by the way, I'm not talking about fancy restaurants, I'm you know, would come to the table and say, I'm sorry, I'm a little slow today because I had an out-of-body experience last night, and I visited the, you know, the Akashic Records. Like, you know, just bring me a couple of tortillas. You know, leave the Akashic Records somewhere else. You know, spirituality is not a new thing to, you know, pretend that you're superior to others. Because if it becomes that, what's the use? So it's better, change inside, but what's the teaching is, change your attitude, but remain natural. Don't rub it into people's faces. And don't become an unsolicited teacher. In Buddhism, even teachers who are, you know, ordered to teach by their teachers will not offer advice and teaching unless asked. You don't go around telling people what to do unless they ask you. And even when they ask you, those of you who have been with me for a longer time, you know, even when they ask, you have to actually make the determination, do they really mean it? Do they really want to know? And if you think they don't really want to know, you might not really want to say. Because they will hold it against you. And more importantly, they will hold it against the Dharma. If you say something on behalf of the Dharma, on behalf of Buddhism, that people don't want to hear, you have done them a disservice and you have done the Dharma a disservice. So, be discreet. Blend in. There's no need to, you know, walk around like you are, you know, off the ground. We're all ordinary in many, many, many ways, as we will see later on the stanzas. And the third principle is do not become one-sided. And this has many, many meanings, but I'm going to focus on one. Very often, an aspect of the practice strikes us very powerfully as being like extremely important, right? And we say, oh, well, you know, I'm just going to focus on this. And we become very one-sided in our practice. And we tend to fall into extremes. Particularly, this refers to meditation and post-meditation. You've heard me speak of that, right? Meditation, when we're on the mat, or when we're, which is not only, you know, doing what we call meditation in the West, but all sorts of cultivations, like here we're doing cultivation bhavana. Or when you're reading or studying, or when you're reciting prayers, or you're reciting mantras, that is meditation. Post-meditation is your everyday, ordinary experience, interaction with people. Do not become one-sided. There are some people who say, oh, all I have to do to practice is to be kind to people in an ordinary setting. Good luck with that, because you're not practicing the qualities that you need to bring to your interactions. That approach will fail. You will fall into the extreme, right, of basically backsliding. Right? And if you, on the contrary, you say, well, I don't want to interact with anyone. I'll just, you know, do, you know, concentrated practice alone. Right? Then you are falling into illusion, because the purpose of cultivation, right, the ultimate purpose of cultivation is the benefit of all. Right? So if you're not interacting with others, what good is your practice? If you're not reducing suffering and increasing the happiness of others, what are you doing? Now, you know, there are times when we need to go into retreat, whether it's a formal retreat or it's, you know, it's a more informal retreat. That's fine. That's not falling into extremes. That's not becoming one-sided. Right? What is one-sided is to pursue a particular aspect of the training to the exclusion of everything else. So the three basic principles are being scrupulous, or keeping your commitments, being discreet, right? And don't go around like sharing your, you know, high experiences, and being impartial. Right? Being impartial means you train in meditation, in post-meditation, you train in all aspects of the path. Right? You're not a one-sided being. What if, you know, you went into a gym and you only exercised the right arm? You end up with a huge right bicep and then a noodle arm on the other side, right? So, don't become one side. The next stanza, which is very short, like wholesome fruit, my practice ripens gradually and quietly. Like a lone mendicant, progress arrives without trumpet and drum. Bless me to remain natural, right? Fruit on a tree, right, take their time to ripen, right? We force ripen things now, right? We gas them and we nuke them and we do all these things, right? But actually on a tree, you know, things take their time, right? And they do so quietly. There's not a big hullabaloo about, you know, like, oh, look at that banana. It's, you know, it's ripening. It's ripening. No, it just happens. It's very gradual and quiet process. The second line, that's easier for us to understand. The second line needs a little bit of context. Some of you may have heard those long, long Tibetan trumpets. It sounds like a herd of elephants is approaching, and the Tibetan drums. Right? And whenever a great teacher, the abbot, or an important visitor comes into a monastery, right, those are played. Right? And it's a big, big tempest of sound. But when a lone monk, you know, arrives, there are no trumpets and there's no drums. You know, he just gets in quietly, right? So it's using this image to say, you know, we should, progress is like that. Progress does not come with fanfare. If you expect it, you'll be frustrated. And there's two ways of expecting it, right? One is that we think like, well, I should be, you know, more advanced by now, blah, blah, blah. There should be signs, you know, I should be shooting sparks. The other one, which is more common, is people should be noticing how great I am. How wonderful. They should be playing drums and trumpets when I arrive. Where are the trumpets? You know, if you go to a teaching by a great, you know, one of the very high lamas, the Dalai Lama or the Sakya Trisen, actually, whenever they walk in, they are preceded by trumpets, right? Trumpets and drums. And there's a lot of people who would actually like to be preceded by, you know, and parasols and victory banners and all. No, it's not going to happen. It's not real progress, right? They actually are preceded by those because they're not affected by it. If they were affected by it, they would be the first ones to say, go away, right? When you don't care, when you actually find it an inconvenience, I've actually seen, I spent a month with the Sakya Trisen, who is the head of the Sakya order, and he actually dislikes it. And sometimes he tries to sneak into the temple while they're waiting for him with the trumpets, and he's already there. He says, oh, I didn't see you. Not true, he had to run around. We need to be like that too. You know, we need to look at our progress like a lone mendicant. You know, it will come quietly, without fanfare. And our progress, right, will also ripen gradually and silently, right? This is the advice to remain natural. The third stanza. Another very colorful one. Yaks do not fly, and ravens do not till the soil. It is pointless and callous to comment on the obvious. Bless me to understand the common and uncommon appropriations. We have to start with, what are the common and uncommon appropriations? Most of you were here, right, for the explanation of the mental functions and structures. And we spoke, right, every time we do an act, and remember, acts are of thought, word, and deed, right? All three categories. A seed is generated, right? A seed is nothing more or less than the tendency to repeat that act. Right? That's called a bija in Sanskrit. If we repeat the act, whenever we repeat the act, then we get an impression or a fat seed, right? We've fattened the seed, which has a greater probability of being repeated, that action, right? If we continue to engage in that activity, we then have a formation, a karmic formation, which is almost like a groove. And whenever the conditions are similar, right, we have a spontaneous tendency to engage in that activity, right? It's not only a tendency now, it's our habit. Yes.
So, this is kind of a dumb example, but let's say that, you know, you eat like at work, I eat lunch at 1:30 every day.
Yes.
And on weekends, even if I've just eaten at noon, at 1:30, it's like, oh, so mean.
Yes. That kind of thing? And that's what we would call a neutral karmic formation. But there are some that are not so neutral, right? Karmic formations can be neutral, but they can also be positive and negative. And most of them, unfortunately, tend towards the negative side. So, what we are saying here is, and those karmic formations we're talking still within this life, but when we take rebirth, those karmic formations actually determine our form, our capacity, our senses, our consciousness in the next life, right? And those we call appropriations. You can think of it as a karmic formation is something that is in the making and it's within one life, and appropriation is something that transcends one life. And of the appropriations, there's two kinds. There's the common appropriation and there is the particular or the individual. What is the difference? Well, in this room, we're all human beings, right? So we have common karmic appropriations. We have, you know, more or less similar bodies, more or less similar sense capacity. There's many things that we have in common. We have, you know, common needs, etc., common experiences. But we also have some that are particular or peculiar to ourselves. And those are uncommon, meaning we don't share them, right? You have your own history, you have your own tendencies. Just because you're human doesn't mean that you do what every other human does, right? Even within our family. I used to ask this question of people, like, who does not have a weird family member? Right? And in many cases, we may be the weird family member, right? So even within a family, there's great diversity. Those are uncommon appropriations, right? So you see the difference between common and uncommon, like all dogs have a certain range of hearing, but some dogs have more acute hearing than others. Okay. All humans, right, have a certain degree of intelligence, but some humans are more intelligent than others. So those are the common and uncommon appropriations. So what are we saying? This is in reference to the instruction, don't contemplate others' defects. People have certain limitations that come with their appropriations. So yaks do not fly. You know what a yak is, right? It's like a big, big, heavy cow, a big Tibetan cow. They don't fly. It's not their appropriation, right? That's how they are. No matter how much you try to train a yak to fly, it will not fly. And ravens do not till the soil. You cannot teach a raven to till the soil. So you can teach a yak. Yaks are used as oxen in Tibet, right, to help till the soil. So what this is telling us is, like, you have to respect that every sentient being is born with a particular common and uncommon appropriation. Do not, what is that? You can't expect sentient beings to do what is not in them. So what we may consider defects, and this is particularly, you know, we think that it's okay for some reason to judge people who are, I don't know, ugly or have disabilities or even no interest in the Dharma without stopping to think, you know, that is their appropriations. Appropriations are not only physical, they're also mental. So to disparage people because they are stupid, and I'm not using the word stupid as an insult. I mean, stupid also has a meaning, right? Not very bright. It says here, it is pointless and callous to comment on the obvious. What do we gain and what do they gain? And we say, oh, you're stupid. Oh, you're ugly. Oh, you know. You're blind. Oh, So that's what it means, you know, this instruction, do not contemplate others' defects. They have them, and you know what? We have them too, from another point of view, from the point of view of a deva, of a superior being, we may be laughable too. Right? I'm sure, you know, we make fun of others. We think we are superior to others, and there's a lot of people who think they're superior to us. And we don't like it if they tell us. Like when young people tell us, well, you're old. Well, it's true, but do they have to say it? It's pointless. It's not like I forgot. Right? And it's callous. Right? In other words, if I don't ask for the senior discount, do not offer. You know, people in the Northeast don't do that. When I was driving down, moving down here, it first happened, I think it was in Kentucky or Tennessee. Like, people in the Northeast would not dare. They could see you like falling into, you know, shards because you're ancient. But they will not offer you a senior discount unless you ask. But I stopped, you know, I was driving and I stopped to get some coffee. It's very nice. Young lady said, I said, you know, could I have a cup of coffee? She said, would you like the senior discount? No.
Back in Pittsburgh, whenever I was out with my children, oh, Grandpa's taking you out today.
Wow. Well, that's pointless and callous, yes.
Does that word appropriation, that like mean it's appropriate that this be happening because of precedent?
Appropriation is the word that we've used for upadana, is a Sanskrit. Upadana means... it's those conditions that are somewhat inalterable for a particular life. Yeah, congenital, they're kind of firmly established for that lifetime. Compared to, for example, karmic formations you can change during a lifetime. Appropriations, no. Like if you're born, you know, 4'2". Well, you're not born. If you're born 4'2", you're a giant. But if you, you know, that's how much you grow. You know, no matter what amount of spiritual cultivation you do, you're not going to be 6'9". Not going to happen, right? There's some appropriations. And, for example, you can, within the capacities that you have, you can certainly, you know, expand your skill set. But you're not going to be able to go beyond that. Right? Just like it says here, you know, yaks will not fly. There's no way. You know, you can get them in shape, you can make them run, you can put them on a treadmill. They're not going to fly. Right? It's not going to happen. And ravens will not till the soil. It's not going to happen. So they are basically, I'm not going to use the word permanent, but they are firmly established characteristics for one particular life. Yes?
In some ways, that's kind of depressing. Especially because I try to inspire a lot of people because I've been inspired.
Yes.
And a lot of people have been written off, and I think for that very reason, people look at certain individuals and say, oh, well, this is just their life.
Yes.
But I've also seen people be transformed by...
But it's not beyond their capacity. They always have that capacity. We're not here saying, you know, cut people short. No. People should be, all sentient beings should be all they can be. But one should not expect of them things that they cannot do. Because then you're actually setting them up for failure. Like, the biggest lie, I'm sorry, but it's the biggest lie in America, is that everybody can grow up to be president. Right. Mm-hmm. It's not true. Not everybody has that capacity for lies. I'm sorry, but it's true. Not everybody has that capacity.
Or if you work hard, you'll get far.
Yes, well, yes, you can get far, the unemployment line is pretty...
Right.
No, yeah, there. So what I'm saying is that, no, this is not a way of putting down people, but it's a way also, but also it's a way of not demanding of people, or of all sentient beings, what they cannot do.
How would you know?
Well,
I have the capacity not to be a drunk, but I don't have the capacity to dunk.
Yes. There are some things, for example, everybody can better themselves within... Let me rephrase that. Most of us are not utilizing 100% of what we have now. We're not. So there's a long, long, way to go. However, we should not place goals for ourselves or for us. Remember, this is not only for others, it's also for ourselves. We should not make unrealistic goals for people. Like, let me give you an example. America's full of pageants, right? Like, little girls, they all want to be like Miss Universe, so they begin small. And you know that this is huge in this country, right? Pageants for little girls, right? And, or even in sports, how many kids are diverted from their true potential because they are told that they could become professional athletes? You know how many, what percentage of the population can make a living out of sports? The ones that do make a lot of money, but what percentage of the population are they? Very, very small. And, they could be cultivating other capacities that they have. Or, many of you here in Zoom are women. How many women are given the false goal of marrying well? Right? Instead of cultivating their own capacities. And they divert their attention to that. I mean, they give up. There used to be a joke, not a very good one, but that men went to the university to get a master and women went to the university to get a mister. And how many women, gave up potential studies, career? We still have it in religion. How many religions today do not believe that women are capable of being religious teachers? Most. So, this is not an indication, this is not an instruction to put people down, but it's an instruction not to demand of them what is beyond their present capacity. There will be another one further on that says, do not, I can't remember right now the exact wording, but it's basically do not place the oxen's load on a cow.
Don't expect the cow to carry what an oxen can.
Exactly, because you'll kill the cow. I don't know if you've seen the difference, right? But boy, it's a difference in the thousands of pounds. So we have to be very careful not to push people beyond their capacity because we're doing them a disservice. Then they'll actually believe that they're incompetent, that they're no good. If I go into a, even the brightest children, right? If I go into a room, they're very young, and I try to teach them to do, high calculus. How many of them are actually going to be able to do it? They don't have the in-between steps, right? They haven't even started to add and subtract, and I'm trying to get them to do high calculus You know what's going to happen? Most of the kids there will say, ooh, I don't like math. They'll never try it. Because we've done this of this demanding something that's beyond their capacity. Okay? So, bless me to understand the common and uncommon appropriations. And that is also for us. I see this all the time. And remember, you know, this was written originally at a time where people thought that to be a good Buddhist, you had to become a monk or a nun. And this teaching in particular is saying, you can be a good Buddhist, the best Buddhist you can be, the best spiritual person, and remain in household life, if that is your karma. Don't try to do something for which you're not suitable. It's much, much better to be a good householder than to be a bad monk. Now, let me tell you, I've met a lot of those. A lot of those. I've actually asked some to leave. It's one of the hardest things because, you know, it's against our vows to disrobe, meaning to take, you know, monastic vows away from someone. But it's not against our vows to advise someone to give them up. And I've had to do that because, like, they were miserable and they were making everybody else miserable. They would be much better in their spiritual cultivation if they weren't pretending to be what they were not. So that is also an instruction for us. What is my proper place? Also, this is an instruction. Karmic appropriations also have faces. I don't want to go too deeply into this, but there are stages of life which the West does not respect. And people in the West think that they can choose to do whatever they want at any stage of their life, and it's okay. And it's possible, but it's very difficult. There's the student stage, right? And you don't actually have to be in school, but it means that it's a preparation stage for whatever you're going to be doing in life. Then there is the productive stage, where you're actually manifesting all your potential. Then there should be a retirement stage, where you're removing yourself from too much engagement. And then there is a withdrawal stage, where you're actually just, you know, preparing for death and making sure you don't have to come back. And of course, you know, it varies from person to person, but there are some age associations with those stages for human beings, right? And it's very difficult, and that's why people are so frustrated. You know, some people want to be perpetually in the productive stage when they're not. But this society does not look kindly upon, you know, retirement and withdrawal. You know, you have to, like, die with your boots on. Right? I mean, that's, yeah, go for it. You know, oh, age is just a number, you know. And, you know, you have to go out and, you know, even though your skin is drooping, you have to go to the tanning salon and make sure that you look like a Gucci bag. I'm sorry, but it's true. Go to any mall here in Dallas. It's just like, you know, ladies that, you know, should be at home, like, praying and knitting. And they are walking around, like, in miniskirts and high heels. And it's not only the appearance. I'm sorry, it's just an outer indication that what they're looking for is men. Why else would you do that? Why else? Or the, you know, the, do you know that there's been a 4,000% increase in upper arm cosmetic surgery? You know, it's the, it used to be that it was faces that was the most, now it's...
That's because of Michelle Obama.
Yes. You know, everybody wants to look like tight. Well...
And she works hard, so a lot of times people want a quick result.
Yes.
Something quick.
They don't want to ripen slowly and quietly. Yes. They want it now. So what, you know, there's a surgery, cosmetic surgery center everywhere in Dallas. They're all over the place. Mm-hmm. You can go in and, you know, what do you want fixed today? You know, we're living out of our stage, our life stage, and it just brings suffering to ourselves and to others. Right? All right. So the next stanza. The impurities of others become mine when I see them. Revealing them to others puts mine on public view. Bless me to wash my face before mocking the mirror. The previous stanza dealt with appropriations. I mean, that's what we're born with. This is, let's say, like it's like the package that we have at birth, right? The limitations that are inherent to this particular birth. This is speaking mostly about people who are engaged or approaching spiritual cultivation. We see impurities on others, right? What we focus on, that's what we're paying attention to. They become mine. Whenever I start noticing the faults of others, right? That's what I'm thinking of. That's what's in my consciousness. They become mine. I have made them mine. This is not some, you know, metaphorical thing. No, this is a real thing. If I look at defects, that's what I'm thinking of. That's what my mind is full of. I have made them mine. If you're a fault finder, believe me, you're a fault keeper. Finders, keepers. But the next line is very interesting, right? Revealing them to others put mine on public view. Now, when you, one thing is to notice them, and the other thing is when you talk about them, everybody knows that you're full of faults. Why else would you be criticizing other people? And particularly this refers to Dharma practitioners, right? Well, look at him, he was doing this. He's not humble. He's not half as humble as I am. Bless me to wash my face before mocking the mirror. This is just a beautiful thing. Like, you know, if you had like a lot of dirt in your face and you look in the mirror and you start making fun of the mirror. Oh, the mirror, look at that dirty face in the mirror. Well, maybe if you wash your face, the image in the mirror wouldn't be dirty, right? In other words, you know, this is a Christian teaching too. You know, do not look for, what is it, the thing in the
speck.
The speck, the mote.
Right. Before you have a log in your arm.
When you have a beam in your own. Basically, right, every other sentient being is a mirror to us. Right? Before mocking the mirror, we should wash our face. If you wash your face, meaning if you deal with your own impurities, you will actually not see so many out there. You will start seeing other beings' qualities, and believe me, they have them. Everybody has qualities. Every single person. Everybody has blessings to give. The next stanza. If I free myself of the grosser defilements, the lesser will spontaneously subside. This is working with the instruction, work with your greatest defilements first. Bless me to meet fascination with mindfulness, hatred with patience, dullness with study, malice with gladness, and arrogance with modesty. There are five poisons. attachment, aversion, indifference, pride and jealousy. These are the five poisons. Usually we speak of three, but there are five. Three are fundamental. And they have their extremes. The extreme of attachment is fascination. The extreme of aversion is hatred. The extreme of indifference is dullness. The extreme of jealousy is malice. And the extreme of pride is arrogance. Now, if we are ordinary beings, and at least we have some measure of sincerity, we know that we have a strong tendency towards one of these things. We do. Right? We all do. That's why we're here. If we didn't have them, we'd be somewhere in the Pure Land. So what does it mean to work with our strongest defilements first? You know, there's... sometimes we like to start with the, you know, lighter problems. Hello, I'll deal with this first, and then, you know, eventually. And that's not the right approach, because if we have a... that may be true when you're cleaning a house. But it's not true when you're cleaning your mind, because what happens... with what mind are you going to clean the small problems? With the one that's overwrought by the big problem? So if your greatest problem is attachment, right? But I'm going to deal first with, I have a tendency to, I don't know.
Eat too much
or something like that. That's not the real problem, and you're going to bring your great attachment into that. And you may become like fanatical with foods, and you're just going to bring your greatest defilement into whatever little area you've decided to focus on. So it's telling us, be honest, be sincere, look at yourself, and this does not need to be permanent, you know, it's now. Remember, we have to work now with ourselves. It's not like you have to make a determination. For the rest of my life, I will focus on, you know, attachment. No. Right now, what is the biggest problem? Deal with that now. In other words, at every moment, deal with the major things.
Like what's causing you the greatest suffering in that moment?
Exactly. Exactly. Because... the other thing is, like, a waste of time. That's what's making you miserable, so deal with that.
Tashi, is this connected to last week's, what was it, something about secondary practices that I squander my eye?
Yes. That is specifically about practices. This is about the focus on the defilements, because they're treated differently, and that's why we're given here the remedies. If you have a tendency, a strong tendency to fascination, and let me tell you, that's not hard to discover. You know, these are people like, you know, they find something and they're like all into it. It's like, you know, head in, and I love that thing, you know, whoa. But it happens often. It's not like they found their thing. It's like, you know, give them a few weeks and there will be another all-important, all-consuming thing.
Right?
Or person, or situation. Right? So that is, the remedy for that is mindfulness. Mindfulness, remember, is what? Is recalling the instructions. And what are the instructions in particular? We are recalling that all those objects of desire produce suffering. Actually, technically speaking, you will see it in many places, in some other commentaries. The remedy for fascination is contemplation of ugliness. It's not what you think it is. But it means it's the ugliness, it's how it ends. If you're fascinated by something, consider how it will end. And of course, the greatest fascination of human beings is a sexual fascination. That's why the instruction, very often given in a capsule, is, you know, contemplate ugliness.
Or death.
Huh?
Or death.
But the ugliness,
yeah,
it's ugly. It's not going to end well, right? Yes.
I once read this little anecdote that the Buddha or one of his disciples, this young monk, was having trouble, you know, because he always saw these beautiful women, and you know that's universal. And so they taught him to contemplate on skeletons.
Yes.
And so someone said, "Did you see?" And he did. And did you see a woman walk by? He says, "I don't know, but I saw a skeleton go by." So if you can get to that point, you're good.
And all forms of attachment, not only, you know, sexual attachment, but all forms of fascination. You can do the same analysis. Just be mindful that it's not what you're seeing. The appearance is very misleading. What's going to be the outcome of this if you get it? Most often you won't get it, right? We've looked at those three outcomes of desire. You will either not get it, or you will get it and it's not what you thought it would be, or you will get it, it's what you thought it would be, and you will lose it. That's the mindfulness that is to be utilized here. Then hatred is the ultimate form of aversion, right? Hatred is the desire to destroy. And what is the remedy for that? Patience. Remember, patience is not waiting. Patience is the practice of peace. And hatred cannot be opposed forcefully, because it feeds it. Right? So you have, for hatred, the only thing you have to do is practice peace. Actually, not doing, refrain. Right? Refrain. If you feel like saying something harsh to someone, don't say it. If you feel like slapping, don't slap. Right? Or withdraw. Right? But patience, whatever it takes, but practice peace whenever you feel this hatred. And it's unsustainable. If you don't feed it, it's like a fire, right? Start a fire in a chimney. What happens? You know, it may be very hard, but if you don't feed it, what happens? It has to die down. It needs new material. Hatred is like that. Hatred is like fire. It needs fuel. Without fuel, it will die of its own accord. So the remedy is patience. Don't feed it. Don't say it. Don't think it. Don't do it. Hands off. Yes.
I'm so glad I came to this. Paul, it's a good, lovely principle of patience and peace. So, how can you, what are ways you can cultivate it? Because I'll just say, today I read some news about an activist who I love and admire, and they put a bounty on her head after brutalizing her, and she left and went to Cuba.
Yes.
Masada Shakur?
Yes.
Okay, great. So, it is difficult at the moment, knowing all the things that she's went through, being a freedom fighter, mm-hmm. being granted political asylum, being abused by the police, and then having the systematic, like, oppression, and just,
mm-hmm.
it's difficult to practice peace in the midst of such injustice.
Peace is not indifference. But peace is not giving in to hatred, because actually when you give in to hatred, like the desire to destroy, you've actually defeated yourself and your cause. So it is actually much more courageous to not engage, not reciprocate harm with harm. Right? The Buddha said hatred will not be appeased with hatred. If you really want to change this world and this condition, you have to oppose a real alternative. The problem that we find is that we get angry and then we fall into the same level of that, you know, which we despise. You know, in the name of the war on terrorism, we're waging terror on the people here, right? We are doing terrible things in the name of freedom. And it's not now, please understand, this is not a political statement. Everybody has done it. Right now, there are so-called, and I say so-called, Buddhist monks, right, in Myanmar, or Burma, right, who are, you know, persecuting Muslims under the pretense that Muslims are violent.
It's like, so easy to get caught up in the web.
Exactly.
You end up becoming what you hate.
Exactly, which, right, which we just said. The impurities of others become mine when I see them. If I am constantly, oh, the terrorists, oh, they're violent, oh, they're this, that's what I am. They become mine. So, yes, the cultivation of peace is not easy. It takes a lot of fortitude, right? You cannot be moved by anger. I always say this, you know, even to parents, you know, it is the duty of parents to correct children, but if you're angry, know that you're not correcting. The only time when you can actually correct the child is when you're not angry. You may pretend that you're angry, and that's okay. That's wrath, not anger. If it's necessary to, you know, instill a lesson. But if you're angry, better withhold the lesson. Because what you are teaching is anger. That is what you're teaching. You're teaching violence. You're teaching hatred. Not a good lesson. And children will learn that from their parents. That's how we learn. Oppressed peoples tend to be very oppressive when given a chance. People, you know, don't think about it, but you know the origin of the Third Reich in Germany. You know what it was? The horrendous conditions imposed by the Allies after the First World War. The famous Treaty of Versailles, which ruined Germany. It ruined Germany. People were unemployed, people were hungry, people didn't have...
barrels full of money and things like that?
People, yeah, you had to take a barrel full of money to buy a stamp.
Yeah.
A stamp. We, and I mean the rest of the world, we created Hitler. We did. And then we're surprised, how could they follow him? Well, we didn't give them very many choices, did we? You know, we had to, you know, we set up Saddam Hussein. And then we had to go after him, right? We set up Osama bin Laden. We did. We armed him. We gave him money. We gave them a platform. We gave him logistical advice when he was fighting the Russians in Afghanistan. We loved him. Then we had to go for him, right? So we create these problems because we react in anger. If we stop to think about, like, I don't have to get involved in that fight. Right? If I get involved in the fight, I've lost. My cause has lost.
You know, I think at the bottom of all of that, deeper level, it just really comes down to the fundamental illness of the being that says, if it's you, it's not me.
Yes.
If there isn't somebody, they'll make somebody up.
And they do. We have a lot of imaginary enemies, too. We do. And it starts very early on, you know, the monster under the bed, the monster in the closet, the same thing. You know, then when we're older, we project it. It's some country, and they're out to get us. Mm-hmm. It's the same thing. The children think it's the monster under the bed, and the, you know, the presidents think it's, you know, the guy at the other end of the hotline.
In my own practice, sometimes I'll talk to, you know, I'll be treating couples in abusive relationships. The guy will be this big guy, you know, been physically abusing the woman, and he will swear up and down in every possible way in front of me he is the total and complete victim.
Yes.
And he believes it's true.
Yes.
Because in his mind it is so. He's the victim, and this is the source of his.
And he's only reacting to oppression. Yes. Yeah. So, hatred is remedied by patience. Dullness is the extreme form of indifference. Right? Mm-hmm. Indifference is, you don't really care one way or another, but dullness is the intensification of indifference to the point where you don't, it's not that you're not interested, it's that you don't understand. Right? You can't tell the difference between one thing and another. The remedy for that is study. If you don't understand, study. And here specifically, it refers to study the Dharma. Make an effort. I've heard people say, you know, the first time I heard that, it sounded like... But honestly speaking, some of you have been around for a long time. Doesn't it become clearer? It's not really that difficult. What makes it difficult is our level of agitation and dullness. And once that's over, that's why I love to start all classes with a little bit of meditation to sort of get away from that. You know, meditation eliminates both agitation and dullness. But when we are consumed by dullness, you know, when we really don't understand, we need to study more. That is the remedy. That is the remedy. How is it going to ever clear up the dullness if we don't make the effort to study? It's not going to happen by itself. Like my car mechanic told me, it's not going to blow up on you, but it ain't going to fix itself either. The extreme of jealousy is malice. Jealousy is not only to want what others have, is to want what others have, but to want that they not have it. That's actually jealousy, right? When we say to want what others have, it's not I want the same. It's not I want what you have, which means I want to take it away from you. Right? Malice is the extreme form of jealousy where you're even willing to sacrifice getting what the other have, as long as they lose it. Yes! Like, you know, nobody's going to have it. If I can't have it, no one will. And that happens a lot. You know, this is not strange, right? It happens a lot in so-called people in love. If I can't have her, no one will.
They'll blow all their money on attorneys.
Right.
Killed in the parking lot.
Yes, which happens very frequently. Very frequent. Malice, the opposite of malice is gladness. And gladness is the practice of rejoicing in the happiness of others, whether they deserve it or not. It doesn't matter. If they have it, rejoice in it. Because, you know, we are extremely judgmental. It's one of the most difficult things in the world. We see somebody who doesn't deserve some pleasure or some happiness or some position or whatever, and it just burns us up. And it's basically, you know, why does he have it and I don't? I'm better.
He has better karma. That's hard to swallow.
Exactly. Whether they're accumulating bad karma or not now, if they have something that you want, they have it because they have the karma to have it. So practice gladness. If that is your main problem, like you're always saying, like, I don't deserve that. And you know, you don't have to raise your hand, but you know, if that's a strong problem for you, you know, which you can't tolerate. There's some people who cannot tolerate other people being happy. They can't stand it. It's particularly some people. This happens a lot with, I'm sorry, but I'm going to say it, ex-wife and ex-husband. Right? Oh, yeah, I want everybody to be happy except her. Well, no, let them be happy. It doesn't, it's never going to make you happy to feel malice and jealousy for somebody else. How is that going to make you happy? Think about it. On the contrary.
So is it jealousy if you can rejoice in other people's success and you still want it for yourself without taking it from them?
No. If you don't want to take it from them, no, it's not jealousy. It's desire. Right? but, hey. But it's another thing. Then you have to use mindfulness to say, like, is this really going to make me happy? But it's not jealousy. Jealousy implies that you are judging that someone doesn't deserve something, or that you are more deserving of it than they are. And the final one of the five, arrogance, is the extreme form of pride. One can actually be proud and not be arrogant. Arrogant implies that you are proud of being proud. you're pushing it on other people. You're letting everybody know that you're better. Right? In your very, very, very learned estimation, right? You're better than everybody else. And the remedy for that is to cultivate modesty. Notice that it doesn't say humility. And when I first heard this from my teacher, I say, why not humility? He said, no, people who are arrogant cannot go to humility because they will do it arrogantly.
Oh, I'm so humble.
I am so humble.
Yeah. Horns and drums, right?
So the remedy is modesty. You know what modesty is? It's like, don't show. One way or another, don't show it. You know, be modest. That it's the right remedy, because otherwise you're going to go to the, you know, the fanfare, like, oh, you know, like I've shared with some of you, this is a direct quote from a relatively senior monk, senior in years, right, not in cultivation. We were reading a passage, we had read a passage that, you know, one should be more humble than the straw in the street. And, you know, we're commenting on it, and some young monk kind of interrupted him when he was pontificating, you know, about humility. And he started to, like, you know, lash out at the young man, and I said, you know, we're discussing humility. And he said, but I am the senior most straw on the street. Like, the senior most straw on the street. But that's, you know, when you're arrogant, that's humility. Doesn't really work. So just modesty, like curtail your expression. All right. So that is following the instruction, work with your greatest defilements first. And remember, this is not that you have to go home and make an inventory of your entire life. No, now.
That's right.
Now, what's the greatest one? Because it may change, you know. It's, we all change like the wind, like Texas weather, right? It was 82 yesterday, it was 49 today. So don't think like, oh, I have to choose one. No, it's what's the one? If you don't know it, then you have more serious problems than defilements. You have to start, you know, watching yourself and seeing what is it that you're feeling. So this means, you know, when malice comes up, deal with that. When fascination comes up, deal with that. Don't say, oh no, this week I'm working on... People do that, you know. People put schedules on there and say, no, no, I can't deal with that. Because this week...
I'm only dealing with desire.
Exactly, yes. Give yourself a break. Okay, the next... Oh boy. Would you like me to stop here or can we have 10 more minutes?
Keep going.
Be honest.
Yeah. Keep
going. Okay.
The next stanza responds to the instruction, abandon any hope of fruition. Right. When we cultivate spirituality, you know, we've read books, we've heard stories, so we have some expectations. So the stanza tells us, attracting followers, subduing enemies, fame and reward, respect and comfort are vain and selfish aims. Hope of success is fear of failure. Bless me to give up hope. And there's two very important teachings in this stanza. The first one is that don't make spiritual cultivation a vehicle for self-aggrandizement, which for many people it is. It's like, it's my career. This is what I'm going to, you know, shine at, right? This is going to be my way of, you know, getting fame and respect and adoration and, you know, I'm going to make it. This is going to be my way. There's a lot of people, and this is very typical in the new age, right? Who've never been a disciple, but are masters. Open any of those magazines. There's more. How could there be so many masters? It's like they're selling masterhood on eBay. Master such and such, and then you look at their, you know, at their little blurbs, and they don't tell you that they've studied with anyone because they haven't. So how can you be a teacher?
It usually costs $650 too. So
yes. So. You know, it's saying, like, don't go into spirituality for the wrong reasons. You know, better be an honest something else than a fake spiritualist. Right? And believe me, honestly speaking, yeah, there's some people who make it. You know, like, you know, there's some televangelists that really make it big. But again, you know, just like in sports, you know, what percentage of the population?
Lots of people are making money with this, with books. And
yes, but it's still not money. As many as try. No, there's a lot more people trying to make money. It's not, and it's not a money making. Don't really work. So these are vain and selfish aims. But the stanza goes further and says, hope of success, even if it's good success, is fear of failure. They are two sides of the same coin, right? If you hope, it's not that you will also have fear, it's that the hope is in itself fear. What is hope? Hope is the expectation that something that isn't will happen, right?
Usually to your benefit, or always to.
So if it's something that hasn't happened, it's an expectation, there's always, I mean, it's unavoidable to then have fear that it's not going to happen. Right? All hope is fear. We can call hope like positive fear, and fear is negative hope. But it's the same thing. Think about it. And some of those are masters are having, I hope that doesn't happen. Right? Which is a positive way of expressing fear. I hope it doesn't happen.
So what are you supposed to have instead of hope?
Certainty. Certainty. Full certainty. You have to have certainty in your Buddha nature. You have to have certainty in the path.
You're talking about serene trust here?
Serene trust, but even if you don't have serene trust, at least certainty of your nature.
And right. Confidence? Like...
Confidence, yes.
Aspiration.
But it's not hope. Hope is a disaster. Right? It is. It's an expression of fear. It's like, oh,
it's like
if it happened, yes. Hope always has doubt.
But it's wrapped around desire too, right?
Yes.
Because the hope is, it's got desire with it. Right?
And it's lack of trust. Mm-hmm. Particularly for those who have taken refuge, right? In the Buddha, the Dharma, and the Sangha. If you have taken refuge and you have actually accepted refuge, the word refuge, shelter, right? If you have accepted refuge, why do you have to hope? You've been given refuge. What is there to hope for? I hope I get something better. Can I have the Mega Buddha? Is there a higher? Yeah.
The Buddha lottery?
Yes. Bless me to give up hope. You know what? When you give up hope, you give up fear. Isn't that wonderful? There used to be a Swami. He was living in New York when I was staying there. Well, this was years and years and years, decades. Satchidananda. He was very famous for a while. Remember him? Swami Satchidananda, very tall, thin.
My friend,
kindly.
I went to one of his organizations. My friend bought his ashram that never became an ashram in Eureka Springs.
Oh!
They're living on the Holy Land. I know Swami.
Swami Satchidananda coined an expression that was, he said, you have to do it with the neck movement. No appointment, no disappointment. And it's true, right? If you don't have an appointment, you don't have a disappointment. If you don't have an expectation, no frustration, no hope, no fear. So bless me to give up hope. There's no need for it in the first place, right? It's lack of trust to be hoping.
I just thought of something. In the famous poem that has the heaven and the hell, abandon hope, all who enter here, speaking of hell.
Yes.
Also abandon hope, all who enter here, speaking of heaven.
Yes.
So
should yes.
be on both gates.
On both gates. There's no need. No need. And the last answer, all I think, speak, and do is tainted with self-grasping and self-cherishing. If I do not give up these two, even my cultivation will be a cause of suffering. Bless me to give up me and mine. We look at the world constantly with these two false constructs, me, right, the ego, the I, and mine. Mine meaning everything is in relationship to me. It doesn't mean that you actually possess it, because, you know, even the things you don't have, they're yours in the sense that you want them, right? It's, we are constantly looking at the world in terms of me and mine. The distinction that we make is the subject and the object. We are the subject, everybody, and everything else is the object. Right? Me and mine, subject and object. The term used in Sanskrit is very, very appropriate. Graha and grahakam. Grasper and grasped. Right? Because we think of ourselves, I am the one who grasps, and everything else is to be grasped. So, everything that we do, right, again in thought, word, and deed, is tainted with self-grasping means to think of yourself as a permanent entity, right? And self-cherishing means that you think that everything is for your benefit, or should be, right? For your benefit. If we don't give those two up, then everything we do, even our spiritual cultivation, will be a cause of suffering. It's not going to be different from, you know, dedicating ourselves to be a banker. Not that there's anything necessarily wrong with being a banker, right? But it's the end result of being a banker is not enlightenment. And the end result of approaching spiritual cultivation from self-grasping and self-cherishing is not enlightenment. It is deeper and stronger self-grasping and self-cherishing. There will be causes of suffering. Right? So bless me to give up me and mine. Now, giving it up doesn't mean that it's going to disappear, because we could not function with it. Is give up the obsession of, you know, everything is in reference to me. I am the center of the universe. How does that affect me? Well, enough about me. What do you think about me? That approach, you know, which we do have. I mean, it's me, right? What have you done for me lately? World. What have you done for me lately? It's not directed at an individual necessarily. So if we don't give that up, we're going to keep on suffering. Even if we were to dedicate our lives 100% to the Dharma. Because we would be using it to affirm ego. So bless me to give up me and mind. I have gone way over.
But what does it have to do about poisonous food?
Ah, that is the poisonous food, me and mine. Everything is poisoned by that.
That's really, really hard to do, though. I mean, that's a very, very fat to eat. I mean, maybe not for everybody. But
No, it is. But of course, it's like, if you know the food is poisoned, right? You think twice about eating it. So it all begins with awareness. So it's being aware that these things, me and mine, are poison. As I said before, you're not going to eliminate them completely, but it's going to be reduced substantially if you gain the awareness that every time they raise their little ugly heads, me and mine, you suffer. And because we still live in duality, the easiest way to get around this is to think more of the benefit of others. That is the remedy. Like my teacher used to say, humility is not to think less of yourself, but to think of yourself less. And how do you think of yourself less? Well, you're going to be thinking about something. Think of the benefit of others. Think of the happiness of others. Sometimes when we're miserable, oh, I am bored, I am this, I am that. If we can change and move our attention to the welfare of others, immediately we feel better. That's why, you know, volunteering is a great experience for so many people. Because it brings them out of like, oh, poor me.
But also gratitude is another practice that...
Yes.
Balances that.
Gratitude is actually, you know, it can work by itself, right? But usually when we're in the me, we need to switch to at least you, other, for a while before we can even feel gratitude, because gratitude implies that I've received something from others. And if we're too much in the me, there are people here. We just went through a whole election cycle, right? The big thing was whether, you know, well, I did it on my own. Nobody, I'm sorry, again, this is not a political statement. Nobody does anything on their own. No one.
Yeah, but we don't need anybody saying they did it for us who didn't.
Yes, but nobody does anything on their own. Everybody depends on everybody else. For heaven's sake, we didn't potty train ourselves. Let's not go any further than that, right? Like, anybody here is self-potty trained? No, right? We don't even know how to do that. Cats learn on their own. So we have to develop that. But we need to think of others, right? We need to think of others. So please forgive me for going over. We started a little bit late.
Can you repeat that humility statement that you made?
Humility is not thinking less of yourself, but thinking of yourself less. Perhaps you're familiar with the three fundamental activities in spiritual cultivation. At least in Buddhism, they're always identified as hearing, which actually means studying, right? When this was first coined, right? That was the only way of studying, was to hear a teaching. Hearing, contemplating, and cultivating, very often called meditation. However, in contemporary Buddhism, contemplation gets short, what do you call it, shrift?
Short shrift.
Yes. Basically, people study and meditate, but there's very little contemplation. And contemplation is the bridge that makes what you study available to you in meditation. And that's why I think that most people have a hard time with meditation, because they're trying to turn meditation into a form of contemplation. And they are two different things. So very often, and this is a very common presentation that we hear, particularly in the last 100 years or so, that shamatha, or tranquility meditation, and vipassana, or insight meditation, are actually two different practices. Because for the lack of contemplation, they have turned vipassana into some form of like analytical meditation. When the Buddha taught, the Buddha didn't teach two different kinds of meditation. The Buddha taught a meditation that progresses, right, from tranquility or peace to clarity. But for that to take place, right, remember his fundamental teaching, avoid harm, do good, purify the mind. You have to purify the mind, and the mind is purified by removing wrong views, right? Removing the karmic formations, replacing them. Now, simple study, yes, if you remember when we talked about the functions and structures of the mind, right? Every action, study is an action, is a seed. On repetition, what happens? It becomes an impression or a fat seed, right? And on repetition of that, it becomes a formation. Now, contemplation is what turns the seed of our study first into a fat seed or an impression, and then into a formation. Without contemplation, that will not happen. We will keep on having lots of seeds, but they're not planted. They're like thrown, scattered, right? And yes, some of them, you know, by some stroke of luck or previous good karma, some of them may take root, but most of them will be swept away by what? By the currents of our conditioning, of our habits, of our karmic formations, of the sanskars, of the grooves. So we need to, once we get that seed, we need to make a hole for it, and we need to cover it up with soil, and we need to water it, and we need to feed it, and we need to put a little fence around it. That's contemplation. And that's why in our tradition, and there may be others, but I've never seen another lineage that does mind training in this way. That's why we have these prayers. We have the hearing part, which is the study part, and that's what we're here for, right? To study what the instructions are for mind training. But then you go home with the means to do contemplation. And what does contemplation mean? Contemplation means to bring the study, what you've heard, into your experience. And I will share with you, there's many ways of doing it, but one that I find works very well, and it's very traditional, is once you've understood something, tell it to yourself in your own words. What does this mean to me? That's the first step. Second step, apply it to your experience and use a three-step process. Apply that thing, whatever it means to you, to some event in your past and see how that would be different or would have been different if you had had that knowledge then, that wisdom then. It's much easier to look at something that already is gone, right? I actually recommend that you don't use any traumatic events, because then you're just going to go into the loop, right? No, something simple. When you've done that, then look at some present situation and how would you apply this new wisdom in this situation now, that's happening now. And then actually project into a potential event and see how you would utilize this wisdom. So that usually is a very good way of contemplating. Very simple, right? First, tell it to yourself in your own words. Second, apply it to an event in the past. Third, apply it to an event in the present. And fourth, apply it to an event in the future, in your future. And don't go too far away, like 59 and a half years from now. No. Something that you've already planned, right? I'm going to go meet my mother-in-law, right? Next Sunday, right? This is how I will approach that episode, right? Whatever it may be. Does this make sense to you? And these prayers are ways of getting that seed and pushing it into the earth and giving it water and giving it warmth and giving it sustenance and protecting it, because otherwise it will fly away. How many times, let's be honest, how many times we've understood something clearly, and then after a while, what was that? What did I just understand? Or like, you know, in our younger days when we had like brilliant ideas, and then the next, and we write them down, and the next morning we look at them and say, oh. What was I thinking? Things fly away. They don't stay in the mind unless you put them. Imagine if you had only heard once, 2 + 2 = 4. Would you know it? How many times does it take hearing 2 + 2 = 4 until you don't have to think about it, until it's, you know, whenever you find 2 + 2, you find 4. Right? Of course, modern children don't have that advantage. They have to say 2 + 2 = x. If x... Oh, poor kids. New math. So this is a method of contemplation. Contemplation is absolutely essential. Absolutely essential. So please let us dedicate.
By the merit accrued through all our virtuous acts, may all be free from suffering and the causes of suffering. May all embrace happiness and the causes of happiness. May all abide in peace free from self-grasping. May all attain the union of wisdom and compassion. Om Ah Mum Soha.